Very good evening to all. May I seek the permission of the Lordship to commence the program. Thank you, my lord. Now I request Honorable Sri Justice Arvind Kumar, Judge, High Court of Karnataka and Chairman, Committee for Computers and Technology to deliver welcome and keynote address. Please, my lord.
A very good evening. Most respected Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairman of the E-Committee, Honorable Mr. Justice Mohan M. Shantanagowda, Honorable Mr. Justice S. Abdul Nazir, Honorable Mr. Justice A.S. Bopanna, Judges Supreme Court of India, Honorable Mr. Justice Abhay Srinivas Oka, Chief Justice of High Court of Karnataka, Honorable Mrs. Justice B.V. Nagaratna, Honorable Mr. Justice Alok Arade, Honorable Mrs. Justice Sujata, Honorable Mr. Justice Narendar, Judges of High Court of Karnataka, Honorable Mr. Justice Michael D. Kunna, Honorable Mr. Justice S.R. Krishnakumar, Honorable Mr. Justice Suraj Govindraj, Honorable Justice Sanjay Gowda, Judges High Court of Karnataka and members of the E-Committee. My esteemed brother and sister judges of the High Court of Karnataka, both in the principal bench and benches at Kalburgi and Dharwad. Honorable Mr. Justice R.C. Chavan, Vice Chairman E-Committee, Supreme Court of India, Sri Prabhuling Navadgi, Learned Advocate General, Sri M.B. Nargund and Sri C. Shashikanta, Learned Additional and Assistant Solicitor Generals of India, High Court of Karnataka, and Law Officers of Central Government, Sri Kamal Pant, Commissioner of Police, Bangalore City, Sri P.V. Bhatt, State Informatics Officer and Deputy Director General of NIC, Bangalore, Sri J.M. Anil Kumar, Chairman, Karnataka State Bar Council, Sri Uts, A.P. Ranganath, Sri A.M. Gangadharaya, Sri Shivamurthy, President, Secretary and Treasurer of Advocates Association, Bengaluru, Registrar General, Registrar of Computers, Central Project Coordinator and other Registrars of High Court of Karnataka, Sri Uts Anil Katti and Venkatesh Nayak, Principal District and Sessions Judge, Bangalore City and Bangalore Rural, Chief Judicial Magistrate of Bangalore City, Officers of National Informatics Center, Bangalore, Technical Team of Computer and Technology, High Court of Karnataka, Chairmen of the Computer Committee of all the states, CPCs of all the states, Learned Advocates, members of the print and electronic media, special invitees, ladies and gentlemen. I warmly welcome each one of you to this auspicious function. We have with us today Honorable Dr. Justice Chandrachud, under whose tutelage and constant guidance we are able to upscale the e-infrastructure not only at the High Court but also at the district courts, and we are surging forward to cater to the ever-increasing needs of the litigant public and the lawyers. I heartily welcome Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud for this auspicious e-inauguration program. Honorable Mr. Justice M. Mohan M. Shantanagowda, Honorable Justice S. Abdul Nazir, Honorable Mr. Justice Bopanna, Judges of Supreme Court of India, have been guiding and encouraging us in all our endeavors. Justice Abdul Nazir and Justice Bopanna were the chairman of the Computer Committee, High Court of Karnataka, during their stint as the then judges of our High Court. I cordially welcome them to this function. It is also my privilege to welcome our beloved Honorable Chief Justice Abhay S. Oka, who has been our pillar of strength and support and who has been encouraging and guiding us with the sole aim to put the High Court of Karnataka at the top of the Indian judiciary map. I heartily welcome our Honorable Chief Justice to this function. I heartily welcome brother judges of the E-Committee, brother and sister judges at Bangalore, Dharwad and Kalburgi, Vice Chairman of the E-Committee, Officers of the E-Committee, Supreme Court of India, Learned Advocate General, Learned Additional Solicitor General, Learned Assistant Solicitor General, Commissioner of Police, Bangalore City, Chairman and Office Bearers of the Karnataka State Bar Council, President, Secretary and Treasurer of the Advocates Association, Bengaluru, Registrars of the High Court, Judicial Officers of the District Judiciary, Officers of NIC Karnataka and Pune, our technical team, other invitees who are viewing this program live, and members of the print and electronic media. I recollect the meeting convened on 10th and 11th January 2020 of all the chairpersons of the computer committees of the High Court and the Central Project Coordinators, by Honorable Chairman Dr. Justice Chandrachud, wherein he emphasized, Lordship emphasized the urgent need of establishing virtual courts to cater to the needs of the litigant public, which is the need of the hour, and to fulfill the resolution passed at the said meeting, we have been able to launch the virtual courts project and also meet other e-enabling needs of the lawyers and the litigant public, which is being inaugurated by His Lordship in few minutes from now. Bangalore city with a population of 1.5 crores is having 19 lakh four-wheelers and more than 50 lakh two-wheelers. Every day, about 9,000 challans are generated and average fine collected through traffic IT software during the previous year was to the tune of 89 crores. The major population of the vehicles driven in Bangalore city, as you are all aware, are driven by ITBT companies, employees of ITBT companies, and for non-settling the traffic challans, the violators are required to physically appear before the court for payment of meager fine amount. The violators can now log in to the virtual court and plead guilty of the offence from any remote location, which facility is available 24/7, and thereby it would not only save precious time of the violator, but would also facilitate instant disposal of traffic challans. By this process, neither violator nor judge would come face to face, and it reduces the valuable time of all the stakeholders, reduces the footfall at the courts, and thereby decongest the traffic in Bangalore city. Virtual courts would reduce the burden of regular courts, and disposal of the cases would happen online in few minutes or hours, which otherwise could have taken months and years. We can also try the cases registered under Section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act and Karnataka Police Case Act in virtual courts in the nearby future. The main objective of interoperable criminal justice system, as it is called ICJS, is to provide online integrated management information system by interlinking the data of the court, police, prison, and forensic laboratories, and thereby it would improve and enhance the criminal justice delivery system. ICJS provides data exchange between the courts, police, prisons, and forensic and science laboratories. In the year 2010 itself, High Court of Karnataka have achieved integration of police IT and the court by drawing FIR and charge sheet to CIS. By integrating CIS with ICJS, there will be digital transmission of data, and thereby it will save time and manpower. This IGS module is now being launched in few minutes, which can be considered as a giant leap in the e-initiative of High Court of Karnataka. We are all aware that physical filing of cases consume large papers, and in this day of demand by the litigant public and the advocates for ease of procedure in filing cases requires to be addressed too. In order to facilitate the advocates and litigant public to file cases from remote location, E-Committee of Supreme Court of India has made a provision for High Court Case Information System and Case Information System National Core 3.0 for e-filing of the cases, including uploading of soft copies and case papers, and thereby ushering the era of paperless courts. In this regard, our High Court has taken up the initiative by interacting with major stakeholders like Income Tax Department, Commercial Tax Department, Registrar of Companies, Commissioner of GST, Chief Commissioner of Central Excise and Customs, and have persuaded them to adopt e-filing, for which they have positively responded and agreed to adopt e-filing in future at the High Court. The e-filing at High Court and District Court is being enabled by going live from today. As a part of ease of doing business and to deal with commercial litigation in expeditious manner, the Government of Karnataka has established 8 dedicated commercial courts in Bangalore city and 1 each in Bangalore rural and Bellary district. Under the Commercial Courts Act 2015, the statistical data of the commercial courts requires to be maintained in the predefined format of the website as contemplated under the Act. The dedicated website provides real-time judicial statistics in public domain and the few information which can be gathered from the website are list of cases e-filed, e-payment received, list of cases in which electronic service of process has taken place, randomly allocated cases, list of cases in which case management hearing was held, disposal of contested cases, summary of commercial cases disposed of, including time taken for resolving the dispute. To all the stakeholders, apart from providing status of the case by daily orders, cause list and final judgments. As we all know, the court fee up to ₹500 was allowed to be deposited in cash and above ₹500 through demand draft at the High Court. There was no online option for receipt of the court fee, and for this reason, an online payment portal has been developed facilitating the learned advocates and party in person to make payment of court fee either on FR number and also by case number, even in cases of where deficient stamp duty or court fee is to be paid. Thereby, the manual handling of the cash and parties coming to judicial service center for payment of court fee is avoided, and it would be completely cashless transaction. POS machines are also made available at judicial service centers where digital payment can also be made. This facility enables the advocates and the party in person to make payment from remote locations. At present, applications for grant of certified copies are received online but delivered across the counter. We are now in the final stage of transmitting digitally signed order or judgment copy through online, and this mode would be started shortly. I would also express my deep and personal gratitude to the IT team for their constant support and for making this memorable event possible in a short duration. I once again welcome one and all to this program. Thank you. Now, may I request Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud to inaugurate the virtual court and other e-initiatives of the High Court of Karnataka by the click of the button. May I request your lordship to kindly click the button.
I thank His Lordship for the inauguration. Now it is time to showcase the initiative launched today. May I request for playing of the initiatives.
Welcome to e-launching of citizen-centric e-services by High Court of Karnataka. Under the able guidance of Honorable E-Committee, Supreme Court of India, the High Court of Karnataka is proactively involved in implementing various e-centric services to facilitate advocates, litigants, and other important stakeholders of the judiciary to interact electronically. As a part of these initiatives, today it's a proud moment for the High Court of Karnataka to launch 7 online applications. The e-services to go live are Virtual Court for Traffic Challenge, Interoperable Criminal Justice System ICJS, e-filing at High Court, e-filing at District Courts, dedicated website for commercial courts, online application for certified copies, online payment of court fee, process charges, and copying fee. The High Court of Karnataka, under the aegis of Honorable E-Committee, Supreme Court of India, launching virtual court to deal with traffic challan offences and petty offences under Motor Vehicle Act. The virtual court under inauguration is first of its kind in Karnataka, so as to dispense with physical presence of violator under Motor Vehicle Act, falling within the territorial jurisdiction of Bangalore City. It virtually facilitates online participation of violators and allows them to plead guilty and to pay fines online. The Karnataka Traffic Police are equipped with PAX A90 devices, which are pre-installed with eChallan app that allows digital recording of offences, fines and notices. The eChallan application integrated with RTO fetches the vehicle details like owner of the vehicle, registration number, mobile number and address of the vehicles involved in the offence. The modality of virtual court is depicted here. The e-challenge generated by the traffic police are consumed at virtual court web portal. There will be a virtual court presided by the virtual judge who would receive the traffic challenge generated by concerned traffic police. The virtual judge verifies the traffic challenge and determines the quantum of fine depending upon the nature of the offence committed. Ultimately, impose fine, keeping open the option to the violator either to plead guilty and pay fine or to contest the case. The challenge and fine details are transmitted to violator through SMS to the mobile number captured by the traffic police. On virtual court web portal, violator can pay the imposed fine. The virtual court web portal can be accessed through the link provided in the SMS. The violator has to select Status Karnataka and proceed. The violator is provided with the options to search his case on mobile number, CNR number, party name or by challenge number. Let us take an example of mobile number. Enter mobile number. Enter capture. And submit. The list of offences is listed along with the name of the offence, act and section and the fine amount. On click of view, one can view the further details of the case like challenge number, CNR number, challenge registration date, police station details and the fine imposed by the virtual court judge. Violator is provided with the options like violator can pay the imposed fine, violator can contest the case. If the name or mobile number is incorrect, then he can verify his case on engine and chassis number and then decide to pay the fine or to contest the case. If the violator wishes to pay the imposed fine, then he gets an option to generate OTP. Enter OTP sent to the registered mobile number and verify. Once OTP is verified, he gets an option to view the summons, understand the contents of the summons and then choose to accept and pay the fine, which takes him to the SBI e-payment gateway. One can pay the fine using net banking, NEFT, RuPay card, etc. On successful payment, violator will be provided with an acknowledgement that depicts the payment details. This indicates the closure of traffic challan. In the event of contest by the violator, the traffic challan will be rerouted to the regular jurisdictional court for trial. Interoperable Criminal Justice System, ICJS, is an application developed for the process of speedy justice by facilitating data exchange between the courts, police, prosecution, prison, forensics, fingerprint, and Women and Child Development System. It ensures to enhance the transparency and reduce the processing time by quick data transfer among the different pillars of the criminal justice system. E-filing at High Court and District Courts. The E-Committee Supreme Court of India, in collaboration with NIC, has developed an e-filing portal as a part of e-court services to enable the advocate and public in general to file a case in e-forms without visiting the court premises 24/7 anywhere, anytime. Introduction of e-filing system is aimed at prompting paperless filing, saving cost and reducing time in filing process by adopting technological solutions to file cases before various courts in India. The High Court of Karnataka is rolling out the e-filing facility at High Court and District Courts of Karnataka. Dedicated website for commercial courts. As a part of ease of doing business, so as to deal with the commercial litigations in expeditious manner, the Government of Karnataka established 9 dedicated commercial courts at Bangalore and 1 at Ballari. In order to place the contents of establishment and progress of such commercial courts and also to place the judicial statistics in real time in public domain, a dedicated website exclusively for commercial courts in Karnataka is being launched. Online application for certified copies is a web portal designed to facilitate the advocate and litigants to file certified copy application in an online mode. online payment of court fee, process charges and copying fee. In order to promote cashless transaction and as a part of e-payment services, an application is developed for online payment of court fee, process charges and copying fee. The said facility helps advocate and litigants in making payment electronically without the use of check or cash. We are thankful to all the team members of these projects.
Now I request Sri Kamal Pant, Commissioner of Police, Bangalore City, to share his views on virtual court. Please, sir.
Respected Lordship Dr. Justice B.Y. Chandrachud, Honorable Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairman B. Committee Supreme Court of India. Lordship Chief Justice S. Abdul Najeeb, Honorable Judge Supreme Court of India. Lordship Chief Justice A.S. Bopanna, Honorable Judge Supreme Court of India. Lordship Sri Chief Justice Abhay S. Oka, Chief Justice High Court of Karnataka. Honorable Judge of the Lordship, Sri Justice Arvind Kumar, Honorable Judge, High Court of Karnataka and Chairman Committee for Computers and Technology. All respected Lordships of High Court of Karnataka, learned Advocate General and other senior office, law officers of the High Court of Karnataka and Central Government, Chairman Karnataka Bar Council, the President Bar Council Association, and all the distinguished guests attending this conference. Respected sir, at the outset, I wish to submit my sincere gratitude to the Honorable Chief Justice of High Court of Karnataka for having accorded me this rare privilege of presenting my humble views before this august gathering of legal luminaries. Today, a major milestone is being achieved in the process of delivery of justice in the mega city of Bangalore, which has assumed international prominence in the last two decades. Respected Lordships, today's Bangalore is the city of dreams for the younger generation. Engineering, management graduates and others after passing out from colleges. Come to Bangalore city with dreams of a bright and prosperous future. Many IT giants of today like Infosys, Flipkart, Swiggy, etc. were founded by these very young engineers. Today's Bangalore is the home of well-informed, assertive, tech-savvy, financially independent youth. This economic growth has also led to a spurt in population, the geographical size of the city, and also in the number of vehicle leaders. This has also led to a substantial increase in road traffic violations. To present my arguments better, I would like to present a slide. I request please put up slide number one regarding the graphs. Respected Lordship, may kindly notice the population of Bangalore has increased from 57 lakhs to 1 crore 23 lakhs till last year. It has been a multifold increase for any city. Similarly, Lordship may notice that the vehicle population totally registered in Bangalore city, including those who are buying homes at Bangalore city and who are off road, has also multiplied many a times. From 15 lakhs in 2002, it has reached to 94 lakhs. Lordships may also notice that the increasing number of enforcement has also improved. The total number of cases have also substantially increased. Before I proceed further, based on my personal experience as a police officer, I would like to mention three instances before this August gathering, out of which two are based on my personal experience. First and foremost is the recent order of the Honorable Supreme Court of India, whereby a historical decision has been taken to allow service of summons through two very popular modes of electronic communication, that is WhatsApp and email. Your Lordships, for any police officer, the service of summons and notices on persons is an important task. However, due to a large number of cases and other professional commitments, long distance migrations, service of summons and notices has become an arduous task. The Honorable Supreme Court of India, in a path-paving order, has directed that now courts may issue summons and notices through emails and WhatsApp. I am given to understand that detailed rules and guidelines are yet to be issued. My only suggestion before the Lordship would be if all the districts and commissioners can be directed to notify their WhatsApp numbers and email addresses so that even the long distance summons and notices could be sent directly to them. So this would certainly be of immense help to police department, which would save their time and resources spent otherwise on physically serving the summons to far off places. Your Lordship, the second important instance is related to the year 2015. As ADG the Prisons of Karnataka, during my visits to prisons, the most pertinent grievance was regarding non-production of under-trial papers before the courts. When this issue was taken up with the learned registrar Confederation High Court of Karnataka, Sri Shankare Gowda, he immediately took up the matter before the Computerization Committee of the Honorable High Court of Karnataka. Therefore, a committee of senior judges, wherein Honorable Justice A.K. Bopanna was also present, held a meeting with the AACS, OTG Prison, and other senior officers, where a firm commitment was made by the government officers that by the government that video conference facility would be set up for trial purpose between courts and prisons. With a great pleasure, it can be mentioned as of today, 25 courts and 97 prisons in Karnataka are connected with each other electronic through video conferencing. This is a very big relief to the under trial prisoners who otherwise were not able to appear before the courts for months altogether. This is a prime example of use of technology in expediting delivery of justice. Your Lordships may kindly recall during 2005, a major skyscraper scam took place all over the country with its base in Pune. The said scam was commonly known as the Telugu scam. Considering the sensitivity and the enormity of the scam, the Honorable Supreme Court of India transferred all the cases to CBI. After the charge sheet was submitted in various courts all over the country, there was a major challenge to conduct trials because the biggest challenge was production of main accused Abdul Karim Telgi and his other associates imprisoned all over the country during the trial. In order to overcome this problem, a decision was taken to produce all the accused through video conferencing. Therefore, with the approval of the Honorable Supreme Court, facility of video conference was set up at Yerwada Jail, Pune, and trial court at City Court, Mumbai. The first trial was conducted regularly due to uninterrupted availability of accused through video conference. Therefore, an important trial was concluded within a span of 10 months, wherein accused was awarded rigorous imprisonment. It is a different matter that the accused were always produced through video conference. We, the CBI officers, always used to travel from Delhi to Mumbai to attend the trial. Subsequently, all the trial hearings of Abdul Karim Telgi were conducted only through video conference, whereby he remained in jail till his death. Your Lordships, the above three cases distinctly illustrate that the higher judiciary is well in sync with the times and technology of the day, whereby appreciating the need of situation, they have modified the procedures for speedy delivery of justice. Your Lordships, as a police officer, I would like to submit that not only the accused or the defendant, but also the police officers are equally keen for a quick resolution of the cases. The recent public decision taken by the Honorable Supreme Court, will certainly make us more committed towards prompt and quality investigation. Today's inauguration of virtual court in Bangalore will have multiple benefits, such as entire process will be completed in minutes. Police resources can be better utilized for other important work. The learned judges and magistrates would be able to devote their time for other criminal proceedings and provide relief to the genuinely needy people. It will also avoid undue harassment to the traffic violators. Corruption at lower level would be eliminated. This will also reduce traffic on roads leading to courts inside the court premises and in the court halls. Respected sirs, I am sure this scheme would not only bring relief for traffic violation cases, but also become a precursor to future simplification of procedures in trial of criminal cases, which ultimately bring tremendous relief for the litigants, police, prosecutors, and courts. Respected sirs, as Commissioner of Police Bangalore City, I assure you that we will not only put in our best efforts to make this scheme successful, but also sincerely abide by any directions to simplify and expedite the process of law. I would like to underline only one point, that since many traffic violators like auto drivers, commercial vehicle drivers, etc., will not be proficient with technology, the technological interface may please be kept as user-friendly as possible. In the end, I profusely thank all the respected lordship for giving me a patient hearing and this rare opportunity to present my points views before you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. It is time to the Honorable beloved Chief Justice of our High Court of Karnataka, Honorable Sri Justice Abhay Srinivas Poka, to deliver the presidential address.
Good evening. Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, Honorable Sri Justice Mohan M. Chandanagowda, Honorable Sri Justice S. Abdul Nazir, Honorable Sri Justice A.S. Bopanna, the judges of the Honorable Supreme Court of India, my esteemed brother and sister judges of High Court of Karnataka, Honorable Sri Justice R.C. Chauhan, Vice Chairman E. Committee Supreme Court of India, Sri Prabhuling Nawati, the Learned Advocate General, State of Karnataka, Sri M.P. Nargud, Additional Solicitor General of India for Karnataka, Sri C. Shashikanta, Assistant Solicitor General of India, Sri Kamal Pant, IPS, the Commissioner of Police, Bangalore City, Sri P.V. Bhatt, State Informatics Officer and DDG, NIC, Bangalore, Sri B.H. Anil Kumar, Chairman of the Karnataka State Bar Council, Learned Registrars of the High Court, the members of the computer team, the Learned Senior Counsel, Learned Members of the Bar, ladies and gentlemen. It is a matter of pride and honor for the High Court of Karnataka that Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, Honorable Sri Justice Mohan M. Chandanagowda, Honorable Sri Justice S. Abdul Nazir, and Honorable Sri Justice A.S. Bopanna are present today for this inauguration of various projects of the High Court of Karnataka. It is said that every adversity carries with it a seed of greater benefit. I am saying this in a context. Pandemic of COVID-19 left us with no option but to take recourse to the use of technology. The E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India, led by Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, stepped into action. Perhaps midnight oil was burnt, and the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India came out with model video conferencing hearing rules in May 2020. According to me, it is the most significant and major step taken by the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India. It is only because of this step taken by the E-Committee of Supreme Court of India that the courts are able to function in a limited way during the present days affected by the pandemic. The High Court of Karnataka adopted the state rules with some modifications considering the local conditions and started immediate implementation of the said rules. In fact, our standard operating procedures provide for its implementation. The E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India has been working relentlessly. The chairman of the committee is the guiding force, and the vice chairman, who is operating from Nagpur, has involved skill to get the things done. For me and my brother and sister judges, this period of pandemic has been a great, great learning experience. Apart from video conferencing, hearing, and its importance, we realize that technology and especially the use of computers can be useful in so many procedural matters. For years, we had made the presence of litigants mandatory for withdrawal of the amounts deposited in the courts. The claimants in motor vehicle accident cases were forced to travel a long distance for withdrawal of compensation amounts. By reason of lockdown, the litigants could not enjoy the fruits of the litigation as they could not withdraw money from the courts. We laid down a protocol for paying the amounts to the litigants only by RTGS, which included a procedure of procuring presence of the litigants via video conferencing for necessary verification. The orders granting bail could not be implemented during the period of pandemic, as the sureties could not appear before the courts for verification. We introduced the system of online verification of sureties by permitting them to appear through video conferencing. For recording settlements, we permitted presence of the parties to the proceedings by video conferencing. The chairman of the computer committee has already pointed out how virtual courts for traffic challenges will bring about a revolution, and that view has been endorsed by the Commissioner of Police of City of Bengaluru. However, as the Chief Justice, it is my duty to mention that it is a note of dissent here. The Advocates Association of Bengaluru has expressed some reservations on establishing virtual courts for traffic challenges because they feel that some of the advocates will be affected. It is said by many that video conferencing hearing is no substitute for open court hearing. But the use of technology is surely a viable and perfect substitute for manual functioning of the registries of our courts. Several citizen-centric services can be provided by use of technology, and that is our objective. Only by use of technology that we can ensure that litigants get some services sitting at their respective homes. I must say here that the systems which we have introduced and systems we are going to introduce hereafter are not perfect. That is not our claim. The technology may not be perfect. Therefore, our aim is to keep on improving the systems. The perfection is going to be our ultimate aim. While I say this, I must also compliment the hard work done by the computer committee of my court. In the last week, number of members of our computer team had to go into home quarantine, which included our registrar computers and central project coordinators. Some of the team members are still not able to join us. I must thank my predecessors and the judges of Karnataka High Court. They have built a very strong system. Though we suffered a setback in the last week due to number of unavailability of number of team members, it did not seriously affect the work of computer committee. During this period of pandemic, a great service and a momentous service has been rendered by the E-Committee of Supreme Court of India. All of us must acknowledge the momentous services rendered by the E-Committee of the Supreme Court. Before I close, I must assure the E-Committee of the Supreme Court that any new project which E-Committee of the Supreme Court wants to introduce can be implemented in the state of Karnataka as pilot project. We will be honored if the E-Committee of the Supreme Court allows us to implement new projects. I again thank all our illustrious guests for appearing today for this inauguration function. Their virtual presence is most welcome by the High Court of Karnataka. Thank you.
I thank His Lordship, Honorable Chief Justice, for delivering presidential address. Now I request Honorable Chief Justice S. Bopanna, Judge Supreme Court of India, who is present virtually. I request His Lordship for a few words on this occasion. Please, my Lord.
Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairman E Committee, Supreme Court of India. Honorable Sri Justice S. Abdul Aziz, Judge Supreme Court of India. Honorable Justice Abhay S. Okha, Chief Justice, High Court of Karnataka. Honorable Justice B.V. Nagaratna, Honorable Justice Arvind Kumar, Honorable Justice Alok Karade, Honorable Justice Sujata, Honorable Justice Narendra, Honorable Justice Michael Nikuna, Honorable Justice R.C. Chavan, Honorable Justice Krishna Kumar, Honorable Justice Suran Govindraj, Honorable Justice Sanjay Gowda, and all other honorable judges of the Karnataka High Court at Bangalore, Dharwad and Kalburgi, Sri Prabhuling Nawadgi, Advocate General, Government of Karnataka, Sri M.B. Nargund, Additional Solicitor General, High Court of Karnataka, Sri C. Shashikant, Assistant Solicitor General, High Court of Karnataka, Sri Kamal Pant, Commissioner of Police, Bangalore City, Sri P.V. Bhatt, State Informatics Officer, Sri B.H. Anil Kumar, Chairman, Karnataka Bar Council, Sri A.P. Rangana, President, Advocates Association, Sri A.M. Gangadharaya, Secretary, Advocates Association, Sri Shivamurthy, Treasurer, Advocates Association, and all other ladies and gentlemen who may be viewing this program. A very good evening to all of you. At the outset, let me take this opportunity to compliment and congratulate Honorable the Chief Justice, the Chairman and Committee Members of Committee for Computers and Technology, High Court of Karnataka, on this occasion of rolling out several features for access to justice through electronic mode. I must also appreciate and acknowledge the effort of Mr. Shivashankare Gowda, Registrar Computers, and his entire team who have enabled this to happen. Computerization is one among the solutions to cut down the delay in justice delivery. It has become an accepted norm that justice delayed is justice denied. The other day, while I was reading an article, it said that the phrase justice delayed is justice denied was first written by William Ewart Gladstone, who was one of the greatest English politician and the former British Prime Minister. But what is relevant is that he had lived during the period 1809 to 1898, which means about 122 years have passed by, but we are stuck in the same position wherein the said phrase is repeated more often. Therefore, computerization is like a silver lining which provides hope for change. In the words of Dr. Cyrus Das, justice is a consumer product and must therefore meet the test of confidence, reliability, and dependability like any other product if it is to survive market scrutiny. He says, delay, in fact, brings disrepute to the justice delivery system. If these aspects are kept in mind in the era of globalization and rapid technological developments, judiciary as an institution will have to be aligned to this situation. Thus, if justice is a consumer product, and if the confidence of the consumer of justice, namely the litigant, is to be retained in the system by delivering speedy justice, computerization is one of the modes. Though several steps were being taken earlier, it was insufficient, but COVID-19, notwithstanding all its ill effects, has acted as a catalyst in accelerating the process of computerization. Like they say, necessity is the mother of invention. I am sure more will be done by the High Court of Karnataka in future also for attaining speedy justice through computerization. I thank Honorable the Chief Justice, High Court of Karnataka for this opportunity and wish them all luck in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, my lord, for the few words spoken on this occasion. Now it's time to hear Honorable Chief Justice S. Abdul Nazir, Judge Supreme Court of India. My lord, I request your
Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairman E Committee Supreme Court of India. Sir, I am very happy that you are participating in the function of the High Court of Karnataka. Honorable Mr. Justice A.S. Bopanna, Judge Supreme Court of India. Honorable Mr. Justice Abhay S. Oak, Chief Justice High Court of Karnataka. Honorable Mrs. Justice B.V. Nagaratna. Honorable Mr. Justice Arvind Kumar. Honorable Mr. Justice Alok Aradhe. Honorable Mrs. Justice S. Sujata. Honorable Mr. Justice G. Narendra. Honorable Mr. Justice John Michael Kunna. Honorable Mr. Justice N.S. Sanjay Gowda. Honorable Mr. Justice S.R. Krishna Kumar. Honorable Mr. Justice Suraj Govind Raj and all other learned judges of the High Court of Karnataka. Honorable Mr. Justice R.C. Chavan, Vice Chairman, E Committee Supreme Court of India. Shri Prabhulinga Navadgi, Advocate General, Government of Karnataka. Shri M.B. Nargund, Additional Solicitor General of India. Shri C. Shashikant, Assistant Solicitor General of India. Shri P.V. Bhatt, State Informatics Officer and DDG NIC Bangalore. Shri B.H. Anil Kumar, Chairman, Karnataka State Bar Council. Members of the Bar, members of the registry, and my friends attending this function through video conferencing. I am delighted to have been invited for the inauguration of the virtual court for traffic challans. I convey my greetings to all present in Bangalore and attending from other places through video conferencing. At a time when the COVID-19 pandemic has halted physical hearing in courts, this is a commendable initiative and is bound to further cause of justice delivery. I congratulate Honorable Chief Justice Abhay Oak, Justice Arvind Kumar, Mr. Shivashankar Gowda, Registrar, Computers, and his team for launching this virtual courts for traffic challenge. The disruptive impact of the coronavirus pandemic is reverberating throughout the world. Due to the pandemic, our courts and the profession of law are currently engulfed in a time of immense change. Courts have found themselves in need of an alternative method to conduct proceedings without the physical presence of advocates or litigants. I am pleased to note that the courts have risen to the challenge and reposed their trust in technology for conduct of the proceedings via video conferencing. Judicial hearings via video conference are now commonplace across the country, and the judges are becoming increasingly comfortable with using technology to conduct court business and ensure that cases are moving forward. In this backdrop, the advent of virtual court for traffic challans Bangalore is a very timely and welcome development. I understand that in this new format, the existing 6 traffic courts will be replaced by 1 digital court. This proposed virtual court will save time and money for traffic violators as well as for the government and all other litigators due to the importance of social distancing during COVID-19 pandemic. The elimination of a physical gathering by the virtual court for traffic challenge is a wonderful way of rendering justice efficiently and conveniently. I convey the very best of my wishes to the new virtual court for traffic challenge and congratulate the officials involved in this conceptualization and operationalization. I am confident that this virtual court will be a resounding success for all the stakeholders, including the traffic violators, the traffic police, and the courts. Thank you.
I thank His Lordship for the few words spoken on this occasion. Now we have arrived to an important moment, namely inaugural address by Honorable Dr. Justice G.V. Chandrachud, Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairman E-Committee Supreme Court of India. Now I request His Lordship to deliver inaugural address. Please, my lord.
My very distinguished brothers, Justice Abdul Nazir, Justice A.S. Bopanna, I think Brother Justice Mohan Shantangowdar is also here. Justice Mohan Shantangowdar, Chief Justice Abhay Oak, Justice Arvind Kumar, and all the judges on the computer committee of the Karnataka High Court, judges of the High Court, my very distinguished colleague, Justice R.C. Chavan, Advocate General of Karnataka, members and office bearers of the Advocates Association, Chairman of the Bar Council, the Commissioner of Police, Mr. Kamal Pant, a very important figure today, considering that it's a virtual court in traffic offenses which is being inaugurated, senior government officials, members of the Registry of the Karnataka High Court who have worked so hard to make this possible, and ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I must compliment the Chief Justice of the Karnataka High Court, my own colleague in Mumbai, a very distinguished judge, Justice Abhay Oak, for this initiative of e-governance by the Karnataka High Court. Before I speak about the subject very briefly today, I must also compliment Chief Justice Oak and all the judges of the Karnataka High Court for the manner in which they have handled the challenges which have been faced by the judiciary as a result of the onset of COVID-19. I think after all the dust settles on COVID-19, the image which we will always have in our memory is of Justice Oak, Chief Justice Oak, holding out a flower, a rose, to a member of the staff who was returning after she had been treated for COVID-19 to welcome her back into the registry of the Karnataka High Court. I think that speaks a great amount of your own sensitivity as judges of the Karnataka High Court for members of the registry, because they are truly the backbone, the spine of the judicial system. Bangalore is a city at the core of India's interface with information technology. Therefore, it is very significant that we are launching a virtual court in Bangalore itself, because we cannot afford a legal system which lags behind the exponential growth of information technology that is taking place all around us. Today, we do not have a choice of whether we will be on the same platform as the new technology which is taking over the world everywhere. It is how well we adapt to technology. At the same time, I'm conscious of the fact that all the initiatives of the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India can succeed only with the cooperation not only of the high courts, which we have in ample measure, but by the cooperation of the bar. Because ultimately, the bar is a very important stakeholder in the process which we follow. There are numerous benefits, just as there have been challenges, some technological glitches of video conferencing. There have been numerous benefits of video conferencing. For instance, I find as a judge of the Supreme Court every day when we hear cases, that every member of the bar, senior or junior, well-known or new to the profession, is placed on the same platform. The name of the young junior is flashed on your screen. A large number of juniors who otherwise would not have had a voice, a platform in a court, are heard on the same footing as eminent and established members of the profession. A large number of women lawyers now argue from the comfort of their homes or their chambers. So that this has been a tremendous opportunity for young members of the profession to establish themselves. It is true that by the establishment of virtual courts, some part of the work will be within the field of information technology. But as we just heard, the work of 6 judicial officers will be performed by 1 judicial officer, which means that 5 judicial officers will be freed to do other judicial work. So far from this reducing the work of the bar, this will increase the work of the bar because more judicial officers will be made available to do productive work, which ultimately will be handled by the members of the bar. The E-Committee of the Supreme Court is conscious of the fact that there is a technological divide in India. Everybody, every member of the bar, particularly members of the district bars, do not have access to the kind of resources of computers that we may have in metropolitan cities. So a decision has been taken recently by the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India to ensure that E-Seva Kendras are set up in every one of the 3,300 court complexes in India. We inaugurated the first of them in Nashik just a couple of weeks ago. And I would like to assure not merely the bar, but the litigants across the nation that the measure of our success will lie in determination of how quickly and flexibly we make available our services to the litigants and the members of the bar. The e-seva kendras will be focal points where services will be provided to litigants, lawyers who do not have access to technology. Recently, we have commenced the training of lawyers across India because we believe that we have to train young lawyers, middle-level lawyers, senior lawyers to be conversant with technology. The member human resources of the E-Committee, Ms. Arul Mozi, has helped in designing video tutorials in 22 Indian languages, including Kannada, so that we will reach out to members of the bar and train them in languages which are conversant and familiar to them. Now, these are some of the initiatives which the E-Committee is taking, and I would like to send a very strong and persuasive message that the purpose of doing all this is to make the work and life of judicial officers, of lawyers, of litigants more convenient, more friendly, more transparent, more open, so that the message of the judicial system and access to justice is spread across the nation. Now, just to give you an idea of the present status of virtual courts have been implemented thus far in Delhi, in Faridabad, in Chennai, in Pune, and in Kochi. Proceedings have been completed in 15,19,000 cases up to date. Fine has been paid in 8,34,000 cases. The total fine collected as of date is 101.7 crore rupees. Violators who chose to contest their cases are about 49,000. Now imagine the kind of productivity which we are saving to our citizens. Instead of spending a whole day waiting in a court to pay a measly fine, an auto driver or a truck driver or any citizen can merely go online and pay the fine, and perhaps pay the fine from the e-seva kendra, which will be attached to the court premises. Another very significant step which has been taken by the e-committee recently is that data from all the high courts has now been linked to the national judicial data grid, except for Bombay and Delhi, and some benches such as the Lucknow bench of the Allahabad High Court. The data of the Madhya Pradesh High Court is also now being made available on NJDG. As of date, 45,07,000 cases are pending all over the country, of which full data is available on the National Judicial Data Grid. The NJDG was inaugurated by the Attorney General for India, Shri K.K. Venugopal, at the meeting of the E-Committee on 3rd July 2020. Now, interestingly, the data which we have for the institution and disposal of cases during COVID-19 from March 24 to the 5th of August is thus. During this period, in all the district courts, the entire district judiciary in India, 20,98,000 cases were instituted. 9,25,000 cases were disposed of by our district judiciary. In the district judiciary in the state of Karnataka, 1,36,571 cases were instituted. 72,324 cases have been disposed of as of 5th of August 2020. Recently, on the NJDG, we have provided a patch for marking the reasons for delay in the disposal of cases. Cases may be delayed for want of securing the presence of the accused. They may have been stayed by higher courts, or they may be pending for want of production of documents. For example, I'll give you a very interesting example. In the Udupi district of the state of Karnataka, in Udupi, we can see from the NJDG that 81% of the delayed cases are delayed for or are pending for securing the presence of one of the parties, whereas 14.39% cases are pending and they are delayed because matters are either stayed by the higher courts, of which 10 cases from Udupi have been stayed by the Supreme Court of India. So we have precise details on litigation management. We would request all high courts to enter the reasons for the delay in all pending cases, especially cases which are more than 2 years old, which would help in classifying delays and assist in the decision-making process. Among the services which are provided by the e-committee is the services portal, which records about 25 lakh hits per day on our portal. The mobile app of the e-committee has recorded around 43 lakh downloads, and about 35 lakh hits are recorded daily. SMSs are sent to litigants and lawyers, and 35,000 SMSs are sent every day. Automated emails, about 3,50,000 emails are sent to advocates who are registered daily. We send automated emails on case status, cause lists, orders, judgments. They are provided to litigants, advocates, and to the police. Recently, we have started providing copies of pleadings by email to advocates and litigants in commercial courts. And we are planning to extend this facility to other courts beyond the commercial courts also. As I said, on the National Judicial Data Grid, we have as many as 12 crore 41 lakh cases pending and disposed of, in which orders are available on the NJDG. Similarly, for the high courts, we have as many as 2 crores, 96 lakh, 98,400 cases of which orders are available on the NJDG. Now, during the course of COVID, we have introduced in the e-committee certain tools and instruments for managing litigation. A large number of cases were adjourned during the course of COVID. As a result of the lockdown ending gradually, fresh filing has increased and is liable to increase even more in our district judiciary. The patch which we have provided to all high courts allows our principal district judges and all judicial officers to manage their litigation, to smart manage the listing of cases, so that cases are not listed all at once. It allows for cases to be spread over. It also allows the principal district judge and the judicial officers to ensure that occupancy of the courts is mapped, so that an advocate who is busy in one court at one time is not required to attend to another court at the same time. So the management tools which we have provided to the high courts are sufficient, and I request all high courts, and I'm sure the High Court of Karnataka will also do that. Justice Arvind Kumar has already referred to the e-payments module, the facility for e-payments. E-filing is a very crucial ingredient in e-governance in the judiciary, because e-filing will enable us to file cases on a 24/7 basis wherever lawyers happen to be, and it will truly open an era of seamless access to justice. I'm therefore very happy that the Karnataka High Court has taken these very remarkable steps. I'd like to briefly refer to the interoperable criminal justice system. The ICJS is a very crucial ingredient, which is a joint project of the Government of India and the Ministry of Home Affairs, the Department of Justice of the Government of India, and the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India, to link all the important stakeholders in the criminal justice administration, the institutional stakeholders, the police, the prisons, the forensic science laboratories, and the courts. Now, if the moment we link all these important stakeholders and institutional stakeholders in the criminal justice administration, we can ensure that data of any part of the criminal justice administration, the filing of an FIR upwards, is immediately tracked and available. That data can be pulled for the purpose of tracking the disposal of criminal cases. So this is a very crucial element in the reform of the criminal justice administration. What I'm proposing to do is that in order to facilitate the complete integration of the ICJS module in India, it would be appropriate if a senior IPS officer is made available by the state government to the High Court, and to coordinate the activities with the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India, so that this integration takes place before the end of this financial year, which will end on 31st March 2021. I don't want to take too much of your time. This is truly a remarkable initiative which has been adopted by the High Court of Karnataka. I compliment the Computer Committee of the High Court of Karnataka. Above all, I must compliment the registry and the IT team of registrars, who really are the moving force behind the initiative which has been adopted by the judges. My compliments to the Chief Justice, Justice Abhay Oak, and to all his colleagues on the computer committee. I would in particularly like to express my appreciation of the unique support which has been granted for this initiative by Mr. Kamal Pant, the Commissioner of Police at Bangalore, and his entire team of officers. These are joint initiatives of the judges and the administration. In our judicial work, we are independent, but when we do the administrative work, we work together for providing seamless facilities to our citizens who depend on us. I thank you for inviting me this evening, and I wish all your endeavors success. I must tell you that it is a great pleasure for me to work on the computer committee with the chairperson of your computer committee, Justice Arvind Kumar, and he has really assisted us in every way to ensure that our initiatives are duly fulfilled. I would be failing in my duty if I don't recognize the immense contribution which is being made to us by the Director General of the National Informatics Center, Ms. Neeta Verma, the Secretary of the Department of Justice, Mr. Barun Mitra, both of them respond to every request that we make for upgrading infrastructure, for making funds available to the high courts, for changing, making technological changes. The NIC team at Pune, which is led by Mr. Ashish Shiradhonkar, is extraordinarily receptive to the requirements of the e-committee. So this is a collaborative effort and not really the effort of one person or one team. I thank you all for inviting me and hope all your endeavors will meet success in the future. Thank you.
I thank His Lordship for having delivered the inaugural address. Thank you, my lord. It's time to wind up the program. Now I'm requesting Honorable Chief Justice John Michael Kuna, Judge, High Court of Karnataka, and Member, Committee for Computers and Technology, to propose vote of thanks. Please, my lord.
Good evening to you, one and all. Today is a momentous day for the High Court of Karnataka, as we have rolled out as many as 7 new e-services or e-facilities, which would take us a long way in quick dispensation of justice. On this occasion, we are highly obliged to Honorable Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairman E-Committee Supreme Court of India, for inaugurating these services and for delivering the inaugural address. The impetus has been provided by His Lordship, and we assure that these services shall be promptly put to the maximum use by the judges, staff, advocates, and litigants throughout the length and breadth of the state of Karnataka. Once again, our sincere thanks to Your Lordship for sparing time and for being with us today. We place on record our gratitude to Honorable Sri Justice Mohan M. Shantamgowda in his absence for his good wishes and support to this program. Our special thanks to Honorable Mr. Justice S. Abdul Nazir and Honorable Mr. Justice A.S. Bopanna, judges of the Honorable Supreme Court of India, for their august presence and for their words of appreciation. As usual, we count on their constant guidance and encouragement. As all of you know, that we are passing through a difficult time. Life is slowed down. Most of our activities are either quarantined or locked down. But I am happy to share with you that there is one person who has been working untiringly 24/7, either motivating the registrars and the computer team or enlisting the cooperation of the advocates for virtual functioning of the court. He is none other than our beloved Chief Justice, Honorable Sri Abhay S. Oak. It is because of his initiative and constant supervision this event has become possible. I would like to express a deep sense of gratitude and appreciation to His Lordship on this occasion. The Chairman of the Committee for Computers and Technology, Honorable Mr. Justice Arvind Kumar, has equally shouldered the burden along with Honorable Chief Justice in organizing this event. He is mainly instrumental in getting the e-facilities functional.
Services. Finally, we take this opportunity to thank the Registrar General, other registrars and staff of the High Court of Karnataka, judicial officers of the district judiciary, print and electronic media, and one and all who are giving this program live. Thank you for again.
We are concluding the program.